everyone, this is the Chrissy B Show, a program aimed at looking after our mental health and well-being. And let me ask you a question. Are you doing what you love to do? Do you jump out of bed each morning looking forward to the new day, or do you drag yourself out from under the duvet and dread the day ahead? Unfortunately, the latter is the reality for many people who are doing jobs they don't like or who are not living their dreams, and this can lead a person to feel quite down. But you may say, Chrissy, I need to pay the bills, I have a family to take care of, I can't just up and leave everything and follow my passion. But are you sure there's really nothing you can do about your dreams? That's what we'll be discussing on today's program. Now, we do love to get you to get to know our regular experts that we have on our show. And my guest today is actually our very own makeup and hairstylist, Sanni Sorma, who went from a job that didn't really fulfill her to something she absolutely loves, which is vlogging about makeup. But she didn't just leave her job straight away. She found a way to make that transition gradually, and she'll be telling us how she did it successfully. But before Sanni tells us her story, she'll also be sharing some tips on bronzing and contouring. And we also have on today our fabulous stylist, Cynthia Liza Gregoire, showing us what's trending in the fashion world. And we'll be taking a look at a delightful cafe that's great for tea lovers with loads of varieties to choose from. And later, I'll be sharing some tips with you on how to find your passion, because you may not actually know where your talents lie and haven't yet discovered something that you love. Now, we talk about fitness and healthy eating regularly on this show because it really does influence how you feel about yourself and your mood. So before we go to the break, let's go to Ben Cooper making a healthy cashew banana bread.
Hi, and welcome to MTS Kitchen. My name is Ben Cooper. And today again, we're going to bring you a very, very simple recipe taken from Nancy Dale's cookbook. So today, again, we've got very, very simple ingredients. We've got cashew nuts, about 100 grams of cashew nuts. We've got two bananas. We've got some coconut oil. We've got a mixture of coconut, desiccated coconut and oats. And then we've got an apple and a little bit of vanilla extract. We're gonna put in the wet ingredients into the blender. And this is gonna be the carbohydrates going in with the fat, which we're gonna actually heat first and melt down a little bit just to give the consistency. Into the slice. And then that's gonna go in with our banana. And we're gonna blend that up and then keep that to the side. Okay, so in with the wet ingredients, I'm gonna add a little bit of cinnamon. Now the cinnamon's in there for regulation of blood sugar. It's great for blood sugars. Along with that is two pods of cardamom. So I've de-seeded the pods and they're related to ginger, which is also great for your digestion. So they're kind of in there, the medicinal side of things. So that's gonna go in. Now our coconut is ready. So that has gone down into a liquid, you can see, which is gonna give the nice wet consistency. That goes in with the banana. It's gonna give a little bit of a fizz because it's hot. Then to that, I'm just gonna add a small amount of vanilla essence just to give a bit of flavor, really. It's not in there for any other reason, just for flavor. Okay, and then all the wet ingredients is gonna go to the side, ready to be mixed in with the dry ingredients, which we're gonna combine in a second. And in goes 100 grams of organic cashew nuts, and we're gonna add 100 grams of desiccated coconut. And then this again is optional. You don't have to add the oats, but I'm adding oats. You can add quinoa flakes, or you can just leave it out altogether and just use the desiccated coconut. Okay, so the dry ingredients are now combined. You're looking for a kind of, it looks a little bit like sawdust, but that's what you want, a nice dry consistency, because then when you mix it with the wet ingredients, it's gonna form a really nice, almost like a kind of a bread mixture. The last element, a nice organic apple, and I'm just gonna grate that, okay? So this is gonna give more texture to it. Just blend that in. And you can see the apple's really added a little bit of color to it as well. So what I'm using is a cake tin. because this is going to be like a slice. So we just pop that straight in. And I'm going to pop that in the oven now. Again, 170 to 180 centigrade for about 25 to 30 minutes. So it takes a little bit of time to cook, but it'll be worth it. And we'll see how it's looking. Perfect. And you can see what I was talking about with the kind of bread consistency. So I'm just gonna cut myself a little slice and try it. Mmm. It's amazing. It's exactly like banana bread. So the kids will eat it, grown-ups will eat it. Great for a snack or for a pudding. So cashew banana slice with apple and coconut. Done.
Thank you very much to Ben. Now after the break, I'll be joined by makeup and hairstylist Sanni Sorma, who'll be sharing some tips on bronzing and contouring, and stylist Cynthia Liza Gregoire showing us what's trending in the fashion world. So don't go away. Welcome back to today's program, which we've titled I'm Not Doing What I Love and It's Depressing. And this is something that many people are going through in life, because they're all stuck in a job or doing something they don't really enjoy and their passions lay elsewhere. But we'll be discussing this more after the break, because first we do have some makeup tips with a lovely Sanni Sorma. Hello, Sanni.
Hey, thank you for having me back.
It's lovely to have you here. I love the new hairstyle. Gorgeous.
Mm, still getting used to it, yeah. But hey.
It's really nice. So we're talking contouring and bronzing today.
Yes.
For the benefit of the viewers, I don't know what contouring is.
Could you yes. So a lot of people get confused with contour and bronze. So you might kind of think that contouring and bronzing is the same thing. They're not. So contouring is bringing out like all of the beautiful bone structure that you have. We're going to do it in a minute. It's actually highlighting and shading the face, whereas bronzing is literally just making it look like you did a week in the Bahamas or something.
Okay.
And the products, I've seen a lot of people when I go through their makeup bags, I do that, unfortunately. And you know, you see people contouring with bronzer, or you see people bronzing with contour. And I'm going to show you a difference here. So this first product here, this is a bronzer, and it's actually quite an orangey color, mm-hmm. because it's a warm color, so it's kind of mimicking the sun, basically. A contour, which is this one here, well, it has a highlight as well, is much grayer, and a contour is always a matte color, whereas a bronzer can be either shimmery or matte. Mm-hmm. Now, because contour is a matte color, that means that it goes into the shadowy area of your skin, whereas a bronzer goes where the sun would naturally hit. So it will be kind of like your forehead, tops of your cheeks, your nose. And I'm gonna show you how I use. I brought some brushes along, brushes that are my big love. And in general, bronzer is with a big brush. So it's the biggest brush you have in your collection, because you don't want it to be defined. You want it to be a veil of je ne sais quoi. You mm-hmm. just look healthy.
Yeah.
Whereas a contour, I'll actually compare these two, is a much tinier brush, because this is in order to kind of like really get those contours. Now, Kim Kardashians of this world, they have made contouring very, very popular, and you see it done badly a lot. So we're gonna do it well, I hope, in this show. Oh, I was gonna show you another product for contouring. So a lot of stores sell big palettes like this. Mm. So obviously there's colors for every skin tone. When you're a private person, you don't need to buy this kind of palette. You don't need to buy these big contouring palettes when you go into department stores and they're gonna try and sell you that. My personal favorite is a tiny little thing. This is by Sleek, and I think I bought it in Superdrug. I showed it. Did I show it last time? I think I did, because I'm quite obsessed by it. It's only a couple of pounds, and it is a really, really good product. Mm. So it has contour and highlight. So I am going to show you now how to contour your cheekbones. So I'm taking some of the product, and I am literally taking it on the tip of this angled brush, and we're gonna find your cheekbones. Now, people think they might not have them. Everybody's got them. It is, if you feel with your finger, just your bone here, and you go just under it very lightly. Always start at the hairline. You don't want the darkest area to be kind of in the cheek here. Always start at the hairline and then gently work towards the face. A good guideline is don't go further than the corner of your eye. So the contour should not be going into the cheek as such. It should just be really to highlight this bone area. I'm gonna show you the other area that we love to do it in. Is if you want a very defined chin line, you just do it just under your chin and there's
and
no
this
more.
Gets rid of a double chin, doesn't it?
You don't have one.
I'm just saying.
You don't have one. Now, you don't have a particularly wide forehead. I, on the other hand, do. So I'm not gonna do it on myself here, but I'm gonna show you ever so slightly is if you have a wide forehead, just go around the hairline. I have to do this very carefully with my blonde hair. And you can go around the hairline ever so slightly to narrow a wide forehead. Now, in order for you to not look completely weird, I'm gonna need to do your other cheek as well. So we're gonna lift very gently. And again, just do under the cheekbone. Concentrate on the hairline and blend it. Always blend it way longer than you think you need to blend it. So if you think you're done blending, blend for another 5 seconds and you're good. And let's do just here as well. So when you add the dark matte color, that's only half of it. So the other half is the highlight color. Now highlight colors can be matte or they can be shiny. I personally like shiny. Like I'm a fan of the shiny highlight. And I'm using a fan brush. These you can get, pretty much any brand has them. And I'm just going on the highest part of the cheekbone on both sides this time. And this is what I do a lot with my clients. It's just the bridge of the nose here. And when you do that, it makes your nose look straighter. You already have a perfectly straight nose, so we're not gonna see much difference.
Help there.
But it kind of, when you draw a highlight kind of in the middle of the nose, it just makes your nose look really straight. Since you're wearing lipstick already, I'm not gonna now mess up your lipstick, but I would also put a little bit on the Cupid's bow because it's beautiful there. Now, bronzer, on the other hand,
make me look nice and tanned.
Is gonna make you look, you already look nice and tanned. I could do with some help on this. So I'm gonna pick up my biggest brush. This one is by Makeup Forever. It's called Straight and Wavy for some reason, I have no idea why. And I, when I'm bronzing, I like to think of it in E's and threes. Oh, and a W. So hold on, I'm really bad with left and right, so you need to tell me, is this an E or a three that I'm drawing now? I'm not sure. It's an E or a three. Anyways, so you start at the forehead, so where the sun would hit you, so that was a three,
yeah,
so this is an E.
Sorry.
You go to the top of your cheek, and then you go under. Mm. So I do that on both sides, but then I do the W in the middle of the face. This is like three letters, the three and the E and the W. So I go over the cheekbone, over the nose where the sun would hit you, and to the other one. And don't be afraid to kind of go into the middle of your face. So with a bronzer, it's not all about, you often like read women's magazines and they're like, do the contours of the face. That's not right. Bronzer is where the sun would hit you. So feel free to do that. A little bit on the chin sometimes as well. I also often, I'm not going to do it now because you've got a beautiful red top on, but in order, so if you've got beautiful color on your face, in order to match it all up, it's great to just do a little bit of the decolletage so that you're not like beautiful
and
bronzed.
You know what I would normally do with that? Is just go all over and not the all that stuff.
No,
that
you need to.
Yes,
so,
it's very educational,
three,
thank you.
E.
And a W.
And a W.
I'll not forget that.
And that way, you kind of like get all of the color where the sun would naturally hit you and not just randomly.
Yeah.
The only place that I don't really put it tons is like when I do the W on the nose because, you know, like often that's the first thing we burn when we suntan and that is often the darkest. I don't put it quite that much.
Okay.
So everything else is like a real tan apart from that.
Well, I'm not going to say goodbye to you. That was lovely. Thank you so much for the tips, but we're not saying goodbye because after the break, Sanni's going to stay with us and tell us about her story, how she would transition from a job in advertising to what she's doing today, which is vlogging, and she's very successful at it. So now let's go over to the styling with Cynthia. Hello, Cynthia.
Hi, Chrissy.
Lovely to see you again.
And you.
And also another new hairstyle today.
Oh, yes.
Everyone's
cut the new fringe. Speaking of fringe, today my segment is going to be on three important F's, actually four. We are going to talk about florals, fringe, frills, and fabric. Yes, so today, let's start with our outfits and then we can go to the rail.
Okay.
All right, well, I'll start with Sanni. And I have styled Sanni in a bit of rock and roll today. She is wearing some gray Sam Edelman wedges because it is wedge season, and it gives her that little extra bit of height. And if you're tuning into my other segments, their gray jeans are a must for this season, and these lovely skinny jeans are done by J Brand. And Sanni's wearing a vintage t-shirt from Liverpool, the Beatles, with a gold Iro jacket.
Love that jacket.
And it's cropped, right? So this is today, one of the things I wanted to talk about was a cropped jacket, so you can see that it's shorter, mm-hmm. you know, than a normal jacket. Chrissy, and yourself, I have you in frills, florals, and fringe.
And lovely fabrics.
So with yours today, we're wearing wedges as well by Ilaya B, but yours have fringing on them. So you get that extra movement when you're walking of the fringing. And we've got lovely silk pants that are by Rebecca Taylor. Now these are come up about mid-calf and they're just slightly flared like a bell right at the end. So they've kind of got that open shape. And also we have this lovely frilly top by Velvet. And in this bold orange for summer. Mm-hmm. So I was going to ask.
I love this color. I just think it's gorgeous.
You guys both
and
look
really
fabulous.
I really like the lipstick that you chose with as well to go with it.
Yeah, today's outfits worked out really well. Yeah. For myself, I have this lovely dress by Dodo Bar Or. And yeah, it's just a one-piece monochrome with lots of frillies and fringes on it. So it's a bit, you know, bohemian sort of hippie vibe, but very loose, very comfortable, very me.
Very and, nice.
Yeah, very nice. Right. So again, and the black and white and the monochrome. So I think I wore that last week, so I might have to wear some color next week. Anyways, we'll go to the rail here. So with the exception of that, that's just, I put this on here just because it was that lovely like orange bright color. You know, we're in the middle of June, you know, go for that extra bit of color. Each one of my pieces today was carefully chosen because of its floral print or the type of fabric. So I wanted to mention, Chrissy, you know, because we are dressing for summer, it's very important that we, you know, pay attention to the types of fabrics that we're wearing because we easily can be stuck in something that you're, you know, can't breathe or, you know, you want to be light and airy in the summertime. So we have these lovely shorts by Paul and Joe's sister, and those are lovely floral pattern. And, you know, a lot of people are wearing, you know, swimsuits and that kind of thing. Why not invest in a caftan? Mm-hmm. And this is just a simple beach throwover. This is done by a brand called Calypso 7. And it's got that very, you know, Glastonbury vibe to it, you know, just the tassels and everything. So that's really easy to wear. You could throw that even over, you know, a vest and shorts at the end of the day kind of thing.
Yeah.
Nice cover up. The same brand here, Calypso 7, has done just an easy floral dress. And if you notice, you know, in the summertime, you have this loose, easy, flowy fabric, you know, things that breathe and, you know, are comfortable to wear. This one is particularly made of just cotton. So we're looking for natural fabrics rather than, you know, polyesters or synthetics.
Yeah, it's very nice.
We have this bright colored one here too. This one's done by 0039 Italy. And that's, I love dresses with pockets. That's another thing that I always look for. It comes in really handy. This one is done in silk. Silk is another fabric. If you can snag a dress or an outfit in silk in the summer, very breathable, very nice to wear.
Do you like that?
Would you wear that? Yeah, I would wear it.
Yeah, this one here is done by Rebecca Taylor. So the same people that did Chrissy's pants. And this one has a drawstring option. So it accommodates a lot of different body types. Mm-hmm. You can make this dress look different, you know, whether you pull this tight or leave it loose, depending on how you're feeling. And it's just got a lovely little frilly cap sleeve there. So it's just about the little details, you know, that you find in a garment that make it, you know, special, not just another floral dress. These two here in particular that I chose, this one's by DVF, Diane von Furstenberg, and this one is by Swedish designer Gani, and you'll notice that they both have long sleeves, and they're quite frilly. The sleeves on both of them are sheer, So it still gives you, you know, that cooling effect. Don't be afraid to wear that. Even on the hottest of days, it actually isn't that hot. We're also seeing a return of some of these digital pixelated prints. Now, the thing with this dress here is actually, believe it or not, and this one here as well, we're starting to see things in the store already, autumn, winter 16. So
it's very early.
It is very early, yeah. Isn't it? So something like this might look like a dress that you would wear in the summertime, but if you actually hold it and feel it, it's a lot thicker. So you want to actually be careful because a lot of stores are stocking both. They're getting rid of their old stock, and yet they're getting in the new collection. So it's something to think about. But florals, you know, continuing on into, I guess, September, whatever autumn is, that's still very lovely. As I mentioned with Sani's jacket,
I didn't see that before. That's lovely.
So cute.
This is a little ditty I got at a vintage store, actually, for a fiver or ten.
Really?
I can't remember.
Oh,
yeah.
No.
It was a great find.
Okay.
So it's got this like thick jacquard fabric. It's got a floral print on it. And again, you can tell that the jacket is actually like cut very short or cropped is what that means. And it's lovely on many different figures for women. So whether, you know, you're pregnant or, you know, it comes up to here. Mm-hmm. So it actually will accommodate a lot of body sizes and look fine.
What would you pair that with?
This I usually will put with a high-waisted jean. Mm-hmm. Look really awesome with that. And yeah, it could be any type, actually even flare jeans would look nice, but high-waisted or mid-waisted to pull up kind of where the jacket would leave off.
Okay.
It's really nice. And carrying on with fringing, we got two beautiful pieces here, one by Raben Saloner and one by Rockin' Blue. And I don't think this ever, you know, goes out of style, right? Like, ever since...
You've been talking about these for a while, so they could just...
And they wore them in the 60s, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, invest in one of these pieces and, I mean, you know, bring it out every time fringing comes into style. Because, yeah, I think these pieces are quite timeless. This jacket's quite unique in that it doesn't have a collar. So you'd have to check what that looks like on you yourself, but you know, it might work, it might not, but it's just something to maybe try.
Very nice.
And we can't forget those men, can we?
We don't forget, because this isn't just a ladies' show, is it? We do cover men's stuff as well.
Absolutely. So men, this is your time to go florals. You'll find florals everywhere. And no silks and fancy fabrics for you guys. Usually shirts like this, because you want that structured look, they're usually done in 100% cotton. So really look for those natural, breathable fabrics, and 100% blend is what you're wanting. This one is from Rag & Bone, and this one's from L'Homme Rouge. And that's just a lovely floral print there for men. What do we have?
This is quite interesting.
Those are some...
They're swimming trunks.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, I'm just checking.
Some swimwear. So those are just, you know, palm trees. Floral.
Okay.
Floral swim trunks. Give it a try, guys.
All right, that's lovely. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
And actually, Cynthia, we're not even going to let you go, because I hear that you also have a story to tell, because you changed career completely as well. We're going to find out why. Actually, I'm going to speak to both of you about that. And you are now both doing what you love. So we're going to be finding out from these lovely ladies how they did it and how they feel about themselves and their lives today. So don't go away.
Chrissy B, and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show, and on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show.
To today's show, everybody, which we have titled I'm Not Doing What I Love and It's Depressing. And I have back with me these lovely ladies, Cynthia Liza Gregoire and Sanni Sorma, because they do actually both have a story of a complete career change. And let's start with Sanni, because yours wasn't like sudden, was it? It was quite a gradual thing. But first, tell us, what did you always want to be when you were a little girl?
I did want to be a makeup artist when I was a little girl.
Oh, really?
I always knew I wanted to do something artistic. I studied arts. I was always drawing, like always drawing.
Okay.
And I ended up studying fine art. So I graduated as an artist, not really knowing what I was going to do with it.
So how did you get into advertising?
Because you don't really make money as an artist, you're kind of suffering. Mm. Yeah. And so advertising kind of just somehow I fell on it by accident, and I ended up working as an art director in an ad agency, in a couple of different ad agencies. Mm-hmm. And even though it's creative and it's quite fun, parts of it are like Mad Men. It wasn't, my heart wasn't in it, because you're basically using your creativity to sell people stuff that they don't need. And that always didn't sit very well with me. I didn't feel like it was who I wanted to be.
Yeah. How long were you doing that job for?
I did it, hold on, almost 10 years.
Really?
Yeah.
And when was it that you started to feel like, this isn't really me anymore?
You know, I felt like that on and off. Whenever there was an exciting project, I kind of got into it, because it's a lot of drawing and it's a lot of fun, like working as an art director. But really, so because I retrained 5 years ago, about 7 years ago, I started feeling like it wasn't what I really wanted to do.
Okay.
And at the time, I also went freelance. So I left my full-time job, but I was freelancing as an art director, but I was working either sometimes in offices, but sometimes from home. So I could kind of start managing my time a little bit better.
Okay, and then when did you actually go into the vlogging that you're doing now and the makeup?
So I retrained as a makeup artist just over 5 years ago. And when I first started, I didn't have a portfolio. I had a couple of kind of what we call style shoots that I had done, like free shoots, but I didn't have material for a website. I didn't know how to market myself. So I just started doing makeup tutorials. My first series was called Iconic Blondes. So I did like Marilyn Monroe and like all sorts of Brigitte Bardot, everybody. Yeah. And it just kind of was more, it wasn't to be part of the YouTuber community in any way. It was more that I could show people what I could do.
But then something happened, right?
Because so it started growing.
Yeah.
Because it, I don't know, I think it was partly to do with, I never wanted it to be commercial, and I still, I don't really, a lot of YouTube channels have grown into basically advertising channels. So beauty vloggers, we get sent a lot of stuff, or like requests to send stuff, and then you're meant to mention it.
Yeah.
And that to me is so back into the advertising world.
Yeah, yeah.
So I kind of just kept my channel as my own personal opinions, my like, I, you know, endorse products that I like. I sometimes say bad things about products I don't like, but I'm not commercial.
Real, real.
In that
but that's
sense.
That's really nice, and that's what I believe people see about that, and that's why they follow you.
I hope
you've got a lot of you've got a lot of followers, and you definitely have. And do you enjoy it now? Is that what
you
like
I enjoy
doing?
It, and it's like talking to friends now. I'm very used to talking to the camera by myself, alone, and it's funny because it does. You know, obviously YouTube generates income through advertising, as but what it started was, actually I started getting clients through it, because I'm now doing Skype makeup lessons.
Oh,
so
good.
Most of my viewers are in America, and they I can't teach them how to do makeup because they're in Mississippi or Oregon. So we started doing Skype lessons about 6 months ago. So
I do
Skype lessons with them. So YouTube kind of like, it's like doing makeup on real people, obviously, is like such as yourself.
Yeah.
is what I do hands-on, but YouTube is kind of like bring the makeup to a larger audience.
That's lovely, and it's fun. You wake up every morning looking forward to what you do, which is important, isn't it?
Yeah, I like one thing that always really, like I was afraid of, because a lot of makeup artists, they're like 17 with no bills, so they're still living at home with mom and dad, and initially you don't work, you don't get very much money for it. So I was always worried, as like, how am I going to make this work? But I was able to, because I was still working part-time as an art director. So I kind of like was 90% art direction, 10% makeup, and then slowly the percentages started changing.
Okay.
Whereas every once in a while I still do some design work now, but it's only for kind of small clients that I really love. And now it's pretty like 95% makeup and 5%
Which is nice for our viewers to see as well, to know about, because it just shows that you don't have to just leave a job and do what you love, because some people, a lot of people are afraid to take that step. If you do it gradually like you did, and you found a way to do it, and now, like, you know, it's the best of both worlds, really.
And I think for me, what was really important was I didn't 100% know if this was the right thing to do, and I kept procrastinating for a long time. But then I just decided that I am, like, even if I take the first step and this isn't what I want to do, I can always change my mind. Yeah. It's not like I'm making a commitment for life. I can decide to be a gardener in 5 years' time if I want to.
You never know what's going to happen.
Yeah, I know. So okay. I would just encourage people to go for it.
Yeah, definitely. Well, how about you, Cynthia? Was yours quite a similar case?
In many ways, yeah, it was. I mean, I went to school to be a teacher, so I went and got a chemistry and math degree. I got an education degree. I ended up teaching high school kids, you know, for 8 to 10 years now. And
were you into fashion then as well?
When you were doing that? I always was. Okay. So I always loved to dress up and all this, but never really doing anything with it other than just dressing myself from day to day. And you know, over the years, I just kind of would get this like nagging feeling at the back of my head that, you know, it wasn't for me. You know, there was parts of it that I really loved. And obviously, you know, I made a lot of money. I had a beautiful classroom, one of the best classrooms in the whole school. I was head of the department. You know, I had a lot of perks that I never wanted to leave.
Yeah.
So even though I had this creeping feeling in the back of my mind, it was really hard to let go of some of that material.
I'd just like to highlight that, Cynthia, because that's very important, because that is there for people when they're not doing what they love to do and they've got another passion. That is always there, isn't it, at the back of their mind?
It's there,
and people just kind of, like you said, because you were had, I suppose, your comfort and all those benefits, it's hard to let that go.
It is. And it just got to the point where I just knew I wasn't happy. And it wasn't the children. I still love the children, and I actually still work with children. As I'm sort of like Sanni, I do percentages of different things. But the administrative part of teaching got to be too much for me. Mm-hmm. And basically that, I just said to myself, you know, I just have to take the plunge and do it. So I moved to London, and I just, you know, basically like took a new degree in fashion, which is so different than chemistry.
That's quite a big step, though, to move to London, first of all, and then do another.
But I'll tell you, Chrissy, I mean, like, even though I'm making, you know, just a fraction of what I used to make, I actually literally do wake up every morning, and I'm so thankful to be in London, and, you know, the birds are always singing, and it's just like, it really feels like something inside when you just follow, you know, what you're supposed to do. And that's how I know personally that I made the right choice.
Yeah.
And it's not about money, and it's not about the material things. It's just about like following what, you know, what your passions are. And I mean, it's unbelievable.
So tell us more about the fashion stuff that you're doing.
So basically I went to school, I got a fashion degree in buying and merchandising, kind of saw how industry worked. And I work at the lovely shop that provides all of our clothes.
Oh yes,
from
by
week
the way,
to week.
Thank you very much to Questionnaire for providing all those lovely clothes that we were showing earlier and what we're wearing as well.
Absolutely. And you know, you start to have just doors opening to you. Mm. And you know, I maybe don't know what exactly it is or where exactly my place is in the fashion industry, as I'm just new to this chain. But every day I feel like I'm, you know, just something else is going into place. So, I mean, I have the styling. I do the styling here. I have the weekly segment. I work in the shop. I personally shop for some clients. You know, it's only going to go up from there. And, you know, I'm not as established as Sanni yet, but I'm not even worried about that, because that comes with, you know, that stuff comes to you with time.
But I think as long as you love what you're doing, that will come eventually, because you're just, like you said, doors will open, because people see the passion in your eyes and they see that enthusiasm, and that makes such a difference. People know when you're not into what you're doing.
You knew as well. And it's just like you literally are just dragging your feet in the morning, aren't you?
So what about our viewers that are watching now that like, oh, you know, they're stuck in these jobs or these things that they're doing. Maybe they don't even have to leave the job, but they just think that there's no way they can follow their dream or do what they really want to do. What advice would you give them? Let's start with you, Sam.
Be realistic to begin with. You know, make a budget. Know how much money you need on a monthly kind of, like, I knew how much money I needed to get by. And plan for it. Save up a little bit and find a way. Most jobs you can do kind of. So it's like, for example, for me, it was going freelance. For some other people, it might be going part-time, or you might do something like it initially while you start building up your kind of like your passion career. And even though it might never make as much money as your first career, it doesn't matter, because I realize that I used to spend like a lot of my big fat paycheck on buying shopping for myself, because I was so unhappy in my work and going, I need to cheer myself up with some new shoes. And now I don't need to do that, because I'm happy. But I do think that you don't need to know exactly how it's going to work out, but planning, so that
6 months down the line, you all of a sudden go, oh my God, I can't live, I have to go back. You don't want to be in that position. Mm-hmm. So having kind of like a security net, whatever that may be, is yeah. good. Mm-hmm. And don't let the fact that you don't know exactly what you're going to do stop you, because I think both of us were kind of finding our way through it. So neither of us really knew exactly where it's going to go. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden you get an opportunity to do something and then you build on that. So it doesn't need to be 100% like, you don't know until you do it for real, you don't know where it's going to
go. Yeah. And it's kind of exciting that way, isn't it? Not knowing exactly how it's going to be and not all planned out.
Yeah.
How about you? What advice would you give, Cynthia?
Well, I love this percentage thing. The math teacher in me loves this percentage thing. So, you know, whatever you were doing before, and for me that was childcare or teaching or education, you know, just sort of like ration yourself off of what you were doing and increase what you want to be doing. And you know, I'm really grateful. I do a lot of like private care of children, and I have a lot of, you know, parents and families that are supporting me and are like rooting for me. And they know that my goal is, you know, I want to be a stylist. I want to be in the fashion world, you know, probably full time pretty soon, but you know, they're okay with that. And right now, like, they support me.
Oh, so, that's lovely.
You know, I would say the percentage thing is quite cool.
Brilliant.
Ration off what you want. And,
I think you're both amazing ladies. You were brave to do what you did, and now you can see just the way you talk about what you're doing now, you can really see how much you love it, and I'm so happy you both made that move. And you know, all the best for the future. It's lovely to have you both on the show. Don't know how long they're gonna stay with us, because they've got like a bigger plans. I'm sure I'm gonna try and hold on to both of them as long as I can, but they're doing brilliantly. Thank you so much for sharing your story, and we'll see you again soon.
Thank you.
All right, guys, so don't go away, because after the break, I'll be sharing tips on how to discover your passion and be taking a look at a delightful cafe that's great for tea lovers with loads of varieties to choose from. And the owner also tells us why he decided to start his own business. Welcome back to today's program, everyone, and we've been speaking about changing career or starting to do something that you absolutely love, because it's very important for our mental health to wake up each day and look forward to the day and not dread it. And if you've missed the beginning of this program, don't worry, you can catch it all up on our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show, and don't forget to subscribe while you're there. Now, before I talk about some points on how to actually discover a passion in the first place, maybe you're watching now and you think, I don't actually know what I want to do in the future. I don't really have a passion for something in particular. It might just be that you haven't discovered what it is yet. So I'll be giving some tips from an article that I read actually in The Independent of ways that you can actually discover something that you can really, really love. But first, let's take a look at this cafe that's great for tea lovers, as I said earlier. And the owner of the business also tell us why he decided to venture out and start this in the first place. And today we are in a place called 280, which is on Farringdon Street, and I'm here with my friend Candice. Hello, Candice.
Hello.
So we've decided to take some time out to have some relaxation time and to catch up and also have a fabulous afternoon tea here. So this place has loads and loads of teas on the menu. We're going to try one of them today. And also they do have a very big selection of healthy options. So that's always good, especially for a show like ours. With Staz, who's the owner of this lovely place, and just would like to ask you, Staz, how did this place come about in the first place and the idea originate from?
So I noticed that there was a lot of coffee shops, but there was no tea shops, and as a national tea drinkers, I felt that the time had come to offer loose leaf tea, and loose leaf tea that was brewed correctly. I found out that different teas should be brewed at different temperatures, so all the tea that we do here is all loose leaf. We do 26 different types of tea. And as I said, black tea we brew at 98 degrees, green tea at 85, and white tea, which is the most delicate tea, we brew at 80 degrees.
So yeah, I didn't know all of this stuff. This is very intriguing to me right now.
Most people don't. We've all had a bitter cup of tea. And that's generally because maybe the leaves have been brewed too long. It could be the water's the wrong temperature, which makes it bitter. Or it could be that the water isn't freshly drawn. So all these different factors make a decent cup of tea.
Just as apart from the lovely teas that you do and the cakes, you also offer some healthy options, salads and things. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, so we noticed that our customers and tea drinkers in general are quite health conscious. So we started offering poached salmon, grilled chicken, and we make 26 different types of salad daily here with fresh seasonal ingredients. And we're really busy. We do about 300-400 takeaways every day at lunchtime. So that's really popular, it's really taken off.
Now Staz, obviously you have your own business. Can you tell us, I know having your own business isn't easy to do, so how do you manage everything and how do you overcome maybe any difficulties that you face in business?
What I've learned is patience is quite important and to plan ahead. But yeah, I mean, a lot of the time it's just hard work. But no, I definitely wouldn't change it for the world.
Definitely pulled it off. It's a fantastic place, and thanks so very much for having us here today.
So that's definitely a place that is good to visit. So let me tell you now about a really nice article that I read in The Independent by Enterprise editor Rebecca Byrne Callender, and I'd like to share some of the points that she covered, as it's really, really helpful to lead you to find your passion in life, because not knowing can be just as bad as knowing it and not actually living this dream out. So I'm not going to talk about all the points, but just the main ones that really I thought were important and really stood out to me. But I'd just like to say, before I actually go into them one by one of the things that I discovered actually through this show was that when you try lots of different things, it's really good for you, and you do end up finding stuff that you really do enjoy doing, which can also turn into a career. So as you know, from time to time I do challenges on this program, and there are some things that I can say were scary for me and I didn't really enjoy, but there were other things that I thought never done before, and I seem to be quite natural at them, and I wasn't expecting that. And one of them was the motorcycle riding, actually. I never expected to be good at that and enjoy that. So I was discovering new things that I started to enjoy, and it was good for my confidence as well. So sometimes you just have to do lots of different things. Just try, go out there and try things, and you may just stumble across something that you love that you can even turn into something much bigger. But let's go to the stuff in the article now. So this the person says you should ask yourself, first of all, three simple questions. Which is the first point here. Ask yourself these three simple questions. So she says, by answering these questions honestly, you can work out what to do with the rest of your life. So for example, what subject could I read 500 books about without getting bored? What could I do for 5 years straight without getting paid? And what would I spend my time doing if I had complete financial abundance to do anything? So that, just by answering those three questions, should already give you a really good idea of what you really love to do in life. The second thing that she suggests, don't presume your passion should be your job. So if you can't imagine not doing something, it's a passion. So it doesn't have to be a money maker. So they're saying make your money some way that will give you the time for what you really love to do. So I think that one is a very important point, because people do get stuck on this and they think, well, I can't do it because, and they give all these excuses because of something like this. My third point, or her third point rather, that I've chosen to speak about, work out what you hate doing. So a very good suggestion, list the jobs or tasks that you absolutely loathe, and once you've eliminated these options, your true passion may become more clear. Now obviously in any job or any career, there are elements to any job that you won't like, you will dislike, this, you know, it's kind of tedious for you to do. We're not talking about those kind of things, that the everyday things that we all have to do in any job that we're in, but that maybe the main things that you could live without, kind of thing. So work out what they are, and then what you really love will become more clear, is what they're suggesting. The fourth point that she says is, find the things that you are mediocre at. So even For example, they're saying even if they don't possess exceptional skills at any one thing, most people have lots of specialisms, as they call them, that they're just okay at. So according to someone called Oliver Emberton, who's the founder of a software startup, Silktide, he wrote on Quora, if you fuse your mediocre skills together, you will find your passion. So he says, take an average business student with some programming ability and decent sales skills. That person is surprisingly well suited to become the boss of others who were better than them in any one of those areas. And he also said that the most successful people, the ones that are most passionate about their work, are almost never defined by a single skill. That's a really important point. And he says they're a fusion of skills, often not even exceptional skills, but they've made their fusion exceptional. So again, they've made their fusion exceptional. So this one is actually quite interesting for me, because I remember having an appraisal with a manager that I used to work with. And I was feeling quite, there was a question on the appraisal form saying, now, what's your talent? What are you exceptional at? And I couldn't think of one thing that I would say I was great at. This is like my strength. This is something that is I'm amazing at. And I went into that appraisal feeling quite kind of discouraged in a way, not feeling very good about myself, just because of that one question. And when he came to it and I said to him, look, I can't think of one thing that I'm really good at. I just tend to be quite good at lots of different things. But I wish I had something that I was like excellent at. And then he said to me, but that is a strength. The fact that you can sort of turn your hand to most things is something that is really, really good. And after he said that, it got me thinking. And I do find that being good at lots of different things actually makes me a better rounded person. I'm yet to discover one major skill that I'm excellent at, but you know, I'm happy with that. And maybe in the future, I'll discover something else about myself. But for me, that kind of being good at lots of different things is actually a strength that I have. So, you know, this point is quite important. So don't maybe try and focus everything on one thing that you're going to be amazing at, when actually you've probably got lots of things that will make you an excellent person anyway. The fifth thing that they talk about, that they suggest you do, is remember what you loved doing as a child. So, for example, did you love to draw or write stories when you were young? Try to remember the activities that you enjoyed during your childhood before, you know, the pressure came to study and all the subjects that you were told that you had to do. And also, what hobbies did you enjoy doing before life got, you know, busy and like stressful? So would you enjoy those activities now? So you can use these memories to help you to actually find the true passion as an adult. And the final point that I'd like to highlight from the article is to create something brand new. So according to Emberton again, he says the secret to finding your passion is to create something new. He argues that people are instantly passionate about projects, businesses, or services that they start from scratch. When you create something new, you're inventing something to be passionate about, he explains. All right, guys, so I thought those points were quite helpful, and I hope they've also helped you, because, like I said, there's nothing worse than waking up every morning and thinking, oh no, I've got to go to work again, and it's the same old thing, and there's just no joy out of life, I think. And as you saw from my guests earlier, they love what they do today, and it probably was scary to maybe take that first step, but they don't regret doing that at all, and I'm sure you won't either. Right, guys, so we have reached the end of today's program, but if you have a story that you would like to share to help inspire and motivate our viewers, then do get in touch with us via the website, chrissybshow.tv. You can also tweet us at chrissybshow or leave a message on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. And remember, you have the power to change your life. Bye-bye for now.
3, 2, 1.
So that's definitely a place that I read in The Independent by Enterprise Editor by Rebecca. Oh, shut up. That doesn't make sense. Yeah, I said bye twice. Okay, sorry.